Lord's given us a beautiful day, and it's wonderful to be able to spend the first few hours of this beautiful Lord's Day together. How about that? Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
All right. Let's stand and let's expect something from the Lord today as we freely and willingly give Him praise and worship. His presence is here. He never fails to show up. He has something individually for each one of us today, so reach out to Him.
Jesus.
inexpressible, unspeakable, and full of glory. That's what this hymn says that we're about to sing together. So put a smile on your face, and let's praise Him together with this beautiful hymn, Joy Unspeakable. Think about where He brought you from.
Let's stand together, shake hands with somebody, greet your neighbors and your friends.
seat after you're finished visiting. You can hit pause if you're in the middle of a conversation. You can get back to it later. We have a song we'd like to share. Romans 15:13 says, "Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing and in trusting Him, so that you will abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit." Holy Spirit, you are welcome.
Thank you.
says that we shouldn't worry about what we are going to say when we reach out to someone, when we have the opportunity to defend our faith or to speak for the Lord, that the Holy Spirit will give us the words at the time that we need them. He is our comforter, He is our helper, and He gives us power. And God is so great, and God is so awesome. Would you stand and sing this with us? You are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is
Hallelujah. A lawyer said to Jesus, what is the greatest commandment? And Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength. And then he said, and love the your neighbor as yourself, which is the law of Christ. That's the greatest commandment. Do you love him that way today? Hallelujah. When you think about the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for us, how can you help but not love him today? Someone put a scripture on my pulpit here. I'm not sure who it is. Whoever did it, thank you. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing so that you will abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. The presence of the Lord is here today. Maybe you have a burden today. This service is designed to help lift burdens. The title of my message is Leave It There. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. But before we get into that part today, I'm going to open the altar for you. If you have a need today, sing that again, Becky. I will worship you with all of my heart, all my mind, all my strength. And if you have a special need today, you'd like to just bring it to the altar, lay it before the Lord, feel free to do that even now as we sing. Hallelujah. This is the whole theme of our message today. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there because Jesus cares. Just reach out to him today and know he cares. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Does Jesus care?
As the bird.
cares. Father, thank you for visiting us with your sweet presence today and lifting burdens here at this altar and in this auditorium. Thank you, Lord, for the reminder. For the reminder today that you are great. You are great. You do miracles so great. There is none like you, Father. You are all powerful, all knowing, all caring. We thank you today. We're humbled by your presence. Thank you for meeting needs today. And we pray you continue to minister to our hearts through the word today. In Jesus' name we pray. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise his name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, choir and musicians. I don't think there's anything that compares to the presence of the Lord, is there? If you've lost his presence in your life, you've lost everything that's worth anything. To feel the touch of the Master's hand is just awesome. The Lord has laid a message on my heart today, I believe is designed to encourage you today. It's a simple title. It comes from a line from one of the old songs of the church. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. It's hard to do, isn't it? Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there and trust him. And in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7, Peter said it this way, casting all of your care on him, for he cares for you. And all of your care carries a lot of distance there. There's so many things that would drag us down. Jesus said in the parable of the sower that the cares of life choke out the seed that fell on bad ground. The seed of the word of God. But the receptive part of the seed, the ground has to be good ground. And if it falls again on bad ground, the weeds come up and choke out. The cares of life are like weeds that choke out the growth of the plant. And so I want to encourage you today from the word of Brother Peter, cast all your cares on him, for he cares for you. Hallelujah. Sometimes people ask the question, is God really there? I mean, does he really care? Is he around when I'm hurting? Is he concerned during my times of hurting and pain, when I'm heavy laden? We live in a society today where many people are heavy laden. Jesus said, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden. And what did he say? I will give you rest. We need rest. Learn how to leave your burdens with the Lord by putting him first in your life. When all of my thought and all of my actions are toward the burdens that I face, I want you to know that he cares. Jesus cares. When I'm tempted almost beyond endurance or the strength to resist, he cares. What about when I make that trip to the cemetery to bury a loved one? Does he really care? Is he with me always as he said he would be? When you leave here today, I hope you have that kind of assurance in your heart, that you're encouraged with the fact that Jesus cares. The word of God is a source of encouragement. I want to remind you to think that he's forgotten you today, that he hasn't, that he cares. Amen. As we mature in the Lord, we need to allow God to have his hand on the steering wheel of your life, not in the back seat. Let him be in the driver's seat. He is not the co-pilot. He's the pilot. Let him be the one who steers your life. I mean, after all that he went through in the Old Testament, the book of Genesis chapter 50, Joseph, the champion young man of biblical history, said these words to his brothers. As for you, you meant it evil against me, but God meant it for good. Why? In order to bring it about as it is this day. In other words, in order for God to work this scenario of you being in front of me, God meant it for good to save many people alive. Therefore, do not be afraid. I will provide for you and your little ones. And he comforted them and spoke kindly to them, to his brothers who had tried to destroy him. It's a great story in the Bible if you've never read it, or if you've never, there's a wonderful movie about the story of Joseph that when I saw it and I saw the reunion, how the actors depicted the reunion of Joseph with his brothers when he revealed himself to them, I can't help but weep. It just makes you realize how wonderful it is when forgiveness comes. You meant it for evil, God meant it for good. He said he brought me out of the pit. He brought me from slavery through imprisonment because of false accusations. I was in prison for 12 years. He has elevated me to a high position in government. Joseph is saying here, he does care. He didn't bring me to Egypt to leave me alone. He didn't bring me to Egypt to leave me in bondage. David said in Psalm 55, cast your burden on the Lord. Can we do that? Have you learned how, with your faith strong, to do that? Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 3, very clearly he said, don't be anxious about tomorrow. Are you anxious about tomorrow? A lot of people are. These are really troublesome days today. But Jesus said, don't be anxious about tomorrow. Here's what Paul said, Romans 8:32. He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him, with his own son, also freely give us all things? That's quite an inheritance there, isn't it? He'll freely give us all things. I think Peter, in the text that I read to you today, casting all your care on him, I think he was looking ahead, looking out for his people. He knew that they would be facing some awful hard times, some burdens. They were already under persecution. Hard circumstances faced them every time they got up. And he's telling you, you'll have greater hardships ahead, but both Peter's and Paul's writings in their letters to the church, they refer to future trials, future tests, but he didn't want them to be overwhelmed. So he gives them this advice. Throw your cares on him, things that would tend to distract you. Now, I don't even have to ask you if there are things that distract you in our society today. There's a lot of distractions, things that I don't think our predecessors ever would have imagined. I mean, even 20 years ago or 10 years ago, who would have imagined the things that are happening in our society today, the laws that are being passed, the regulations that are coming against our people, even as far as our public schools and our elementary schools. You just kind of wonder when it's time to speak up bluntly against some things. There's some things that are happening that are mind-boggling. And they give you heaviness of heart. It's a heartache to think about them. He said, cast them upon God. Trust him with determined faith. Why, Peter? Because he cares for you. And I want to leave you with this kind of trust today. He will either take it out of the way, or he'll deliver you in it, or he'll show you how to overcome it. He'll either move the mountain or give you strength to climb it or the equipment to tunnel through it. Whatever is his plan, trust him. I love 1 Corinthians 10:13. Many of you know it by heart, some don't. How many know it by heart? Ooh. You know what I'm grateful for today, really, really am. I'm thankful, even at the time, I wasn't thankful. I'm thankful for a father and mother. In that case, more the father, was his hand of authority, forced us, literally forced us to read the Bible and to memorize scripture. And then when he was away for a while, planning a church in his hometown in Popoli, Italy, he instructed my mother that we should read every day a chapter of the Bible. And then after she told him somehow through communication that we weren't doing that, or we were reading the shortest ones in the Psalms, we did. I read Psalm 117 100 times, it's two verses. Then we had to write verses. We had to actually write verses. I'm so thankful looking back for that inheritance and that instruction, because it teaches you where the scripture is. When I teach on Wednesday night, I remind the people, learn the address of these scriptures so that when you're talking to somebody and you say, the Bible says, tell them where it says it. It's good to do that. Make that a policy for you. Lay down the Facebook once in a while and the cell phone and get into the Word and learn. The scripture I'm referring to today, 1 Corinthians 10:13, says, when I start it, you'll know it. There is no temptation taken you, but what? Such as is common to man, but what? But God is faithful. That's a big part. God is faithful, who will, with the temptation, make a way of escape. That's a great scripture. You got to lean on that. There's no temptation taking you. The devil will tell you, you can't help yourself. You're sunk. But God is faithful. God is faithful. And he will, with the temptation, give you a way of escape. That is a phenomenal scripture. Have determined faith that he will do that. We need to know that the best of Christians and the strongest of Christians at one time or another come under a burden of excessive care. I've known of pastors in my lifetime that have actually broken, that have actually had nervous breakdowns over the excessive care, personal cares, family cares, business cares, cares for the present, cares for the future, cares for others, cares for the church. These are things that happen. That's why we need to have someone to cast our cares upon. Whether you're a good person or not, no one likes to be loaded down with the cares of life. There are times, hear me now, there are times when having the cares of life press you down can be sinful. It's when those cares overtake you because of unbelief. Whatever is not of faith is what? The Bible says whatever is not of faith is sin. So you have to believe when the pressure's on, because of unbelief. I mean, the world will swallow you up. It'll take your time and your talent and hinder your duties for the Lord. So I'm trying to encourage you today to learn how to cast your cares on Jesus. Whether it's ministry or worship, if it becomes endurance instead of enjoyment, you need to cast it on the Lord. The best remedy for care, the kind of care that overwhelms you, is to get rid of it. Cast it. Give it to his wise counsel, for he does care for you. That's why I had Becky do that song. Does Jesus care? Oh, yes, he cares. His heart is touched by my grief, and he has proved it over and over and over again. The Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians, and let me just read some of this with you today. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, 28. Besides all these other things, and he lists a bunch, besides all these other things, what comes upon me daily is my deep concern for the church. And in Matthew chapter 8 and verse 14, Jesus said, when Jesus had come into Peter's house, he saw his wife's mother was sick with a fever. Now, this is a story that fascinated me. And when I was studying that verse one time, it says in another translation, I was using a kind of cross-referencing different scriptures as you do when you study. The Moffat translation, which is not a very popular translation, and in some ways people say it's questionable. But I like what he says on this verse. He said, when Jesus came into Peter's house, he noticed. I like that word. He noticed that Peter's mother-in-law was sick. And he touched her and he healed her. I mean, not many people notice these days hurting people. That's one thing I have to say that I love especially about our congregation, that whenever there's a need, whenever there's a hurting person, whenever there's a person that's in need, that it's noticed and responded to, and as much as possible, the need is met. And I appreciate that. Jesus noticed years and years ago, William Booth noticed poverty in his homeland. And because of that, the Salvation Army was started and is still going very, very strong and effective in our world today. The slaves were set free because President Lincoln noticed the situation and cared enough to do something about it. Jesus walked into Peter's house for rest. That was kind of their headquarters in Capernaum. And he wanted to be entertained, perhaps, and fed, whatever. It wasn't easy, I imagine, to be Peter's mother-in-law. How many of you are mothers-in-law? Raise your hand. Huh. You can admit it. It's okay. I know you're put down a lot, and all, but I had a great mother-in-law, Bev's mother. She was great. She liked me more than she liked Bev, I'm telling you. Not quite. That's not quite true. But really, we had a great relationship. I didn't know when I married Bev that her mother would move in for 2 weeks and then leave for 26 years. I didn't know that. But it was a pleasure to have her in the home most of the time. But no, she was a great lady. She really was. She suffered a lot of hardship up in the coal regions, and it was kind of like heaven, I think, for her to be with us. But I used to tease her. I did. It's a shame. I still haven't repented of that. That's the thing. But she loved me through it all. We really had a good relationship. But mothers-in-law are put down a lot. And maybe Peter, maybe he wasn't easy on his mother-in-law, but he didn't notice. He's bringing a whole bunch of guys in the house to be fed and to be entertained. Tough enough, two women living in the same house. And here's Peter, impulsive, rough-talking Peter. And he's bringing in company when she's sick. I mean, it's proper to feed them or offer them something. And she's sick. He didn't notice. But Jesus noticed. The Bible says Jesus noticed that she was down with a fever. Can I remind you that Jesus notices when people are down? You ever been down? Under it? Get out from under it. Give it to Jesus. Leave it there. He noticed that she was down with a fever. And he cares. He cares when you and I hurt. When you and I are troubled. When we're pressured. He understands our distress. The psalmist David, and this is a very, very depressing part of Scripture, if Scripture can be depressing. Let me read this. I pour out my complaint before him. I declare before him my trouble. What was he talking about? Let me give you the background here. David was in a tight fix. He was up against it. And I don't believe there's a more depressing scripture. Maybe there is, but not much more than this here. David therefore departed from there and escaped to the cave of Adullam. He's being chased. So when his brothers and all of his father's house heard it, they went down there to him. And everyone, listen to this now, everyone who was in distress, everyone who was in debt, everyone who was discontented gathered to him, and he became captain over them, and there were about 400 men with him. David became the captain over all these depressed, broke, hurting, despondent people. What a sad state of affairs for the guy that killed Goliath. And in that passage, and I won't get into that all the way today, when you go home you can read it, but he actually offered himself to serve. He was so down, he offered himself to serve the king of Gath. Who was from Gath? G-A-T-H. Goliath, the one he had defeated. Now he's going back and offering, and in fact he faked insanity before. It's quite a story. The Bible is interesting. I think it's a crime to make it boring, to tell you the truth. But he offered himself as a servant to the king of Gath. 400 depressed, discontented, unorganized people elected him to be their leader. And then in that setting, David, I believe, wrote some of the wonderful Psalms. Charles Haddon Spurgeon, he's known as the Prince of Preachers, back in the 1800s, said this: caves make good closets of prayer. Caves make good closets of prayer. You can be in the spirit in a cave, in the Revelation. And it's a fabulous scripture. Let me get it here so I can make sure I make it clear. In Revelation chapter 1, John the Revelator said this: I was in the spirit on the Lord's day. He's in the island Patmos, which is the Alcatraz of the Mediterranean. I was in the spirit of the Lord's on the Lord's day, praising him. He was in the spirit in that cave, worshiping God. And he said, I heard a voice behind me in the cave. And he said, I scared him to death. But then when he realized it was Jesus, Jesus said, come on, John, it's me. Remember me? But the whole story is this. He was in a cave in the spirit, and the Lord ministered to him in that place. David was in the pits, and he cried from his mouth. He said, I cried aloud with my voice to the Lord. And I studied that a little bit to get some different translations. One says, I shriek, or I scream. He felt totally wasted and useless and worthless. He needed to know that God cared. You don't have to answer this, but I just want you to think about it. Have you ever come to that place before God where you were so burdened you couldn't put it in words? I have. I remember times where you just burdened for, in this one situation, for a couple that was going to break up. And I screamed to the Lord. I had to pull my car off the road because I was so burdened for that situation. In agony, David was that way several times in his life. He wanted to know. After all the victories, now he's in a cave surrounded by 400 depressed, broke people. And he wanted to know that he was still useful. So the first step and knowing that he cares is go before him. Be honest with God. God, I'm overwhelmed here. This is getting to me. I need your touch. I need to know. Don't stay down. Don't be licking your wounds. Have a pity party. Don't be depressed before God, because a pity party only leads you further down the slope, so to speak. Call his name aloud. Jesus. Jesus. Oh, Jesus! Help me. Sure, that works. He's not deaf, but it helps to know you're serious. Cry aloud if you must. Go deeper in self-pity and you'll regret it. So here's what Hosea says. Israel, return to the Lord your God, for you have stumbled because of your iniquity. Ain't God's fault. You've stumbled because of your iniquity. Take words with you, return to the Lord and say to him, take away all iniquity, receive us graciously, and we will offer the sacrifice of our lips. Well, that's a great solution. When you're there, just confess to the Lord, ask him to forgive you, repent, and then begin to praise him and worship him, and it works. Take words with you. Put your petition into words. Declare your trouble and watch what happens. He's your dearest friend. Dear friends don't keep anything from each other. He is your dearest friend. As Becky sang earlier, cast your cares on him, Peter said, for he really cares for you. Hear this final thought. God will use distressing, difficult days to help you to grow up. To grow up, to be mature in him. And those times of growth will give you inner strength and give you stability in hurting times. People need to know that God is victorious and to know that he cares. And when you come to that knowledge yourself, you will find that you can have ministry to others. Hey, I've been through it, man. I know what you're going through. Let me pray for you. That's powerful. Yes. So look up, huh? Don't look down. Call on his name. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Sweetest name I know. Bill Gaither's song, beautiful. There's something about that name. It irritates some people. You say the name Jesus in some surroundings and you're looked upon, maybe even cursed. I don't even think you're allowed to say it in school anymore. You could say it in a curse word, I guess. Jesus. Something about that name. Master. Savior. Jesus. When hope is gone, when the doctor shakes his head and walks away, when things look terribly down, breathe his name. Somebody walks in and says, let's go to Jesus about this. And I don't know, something stirs. You agree with that? I hope you do. Don't hold back. Trust him to handle whatever you cast on him. We're the students. He's the teacher. The dark cave is part of his plan. So let him turn your night today. Let him turn the lights on in your life. Take your burden to the Lord. And as I said originally with my title, leave it there. I do this once in a while. And I just feel a little song coming on. If the world from you withholds of its silver and its gold, and you have to get along on meager fare, just remember in God's word how he feeds the little bird. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. Another verse says, when your youthful days are gone and old age is creeping on, and your body bends beneath the weight of care, he will never leave you then. He'll go with you to the end. Take your burden to the Lord. Leave it there. You know the chorus, sing it. Leave it there. Leave it there. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. If you trust and never doubt, he will surely bring you out. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. Amen. That's the message today. I hope you learn how to do that. Hallelujah. Let's stand together and be dismissed. And if you do have a need for prayer today, or if you need to come bring something to the altar, some already did today. But we want to open the altar for you. And again, if you don't know Jesus as your Savior, you're missing out on the greatest life that you could possibly enjoy. I say it often on my radio show. I've done that for many, many years. Put Jesus first in everything you do. You will never, ever be sorry. So if you want to come to the altar today and make things right with God or give it to Him, you're sure welcome. There'll be people here to pray for you. Let's bow in prayer. Father, thank you for your word today. Thank you for the family of God, for the privilege of being here in your presence, for the music and the praise and the worship and the wonderful fellowship. And I pray, God, for if there's a soul here that's near eternity without Jesus, that before they leave this building, they'll pray a prayer of repentance and confession and receiving Jesus Christ. For He so clearly in your word said, if I confess my sin, He's faithful and just to forgive me, cleanse me. Cleanse hearts today, Lord, and lift our spirits and make us a blessing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Go with God. Have a wonderful day.